My name is Shirley Wood and I'm the chair for this session, and I'd like to welcome you to the 45th Networkshop. Networkshop is an event that has been going now for 40 years. It first started in September 1977. And before anyone asks, no, I haven't been around that long. This is the first time that we've used Nottingham as a venue, but this specific conference centre, it's the first time we've used this. So what I'd like to do now is run through some housekeeping. Please switch your mobile phones to silent. We have no fire alarms scheduled, so in the event of an alarm, please follow the directions of the NCC staff. And just to remind you, we have an exhibitor showcase and drinks reception at the end of the day. And then there's Birds of a Feather sessions that start at 6 o'clock this evening. And now I'm going to show you a video showing some of the benefits of Janet. To invite Professor Edward Peck, who's the Vice Chancellor of Nottingham Trent University, to welcome you to this conference. Thank you.
Turning your microphone on really helps when you're making a presentation. I didn't, because normally my AV guys do it for me, folks. So anyway, none of you complained, so clearly me just shouting was quite sufficient, or you weren't bothered, you couldn't hear me. I'll take it as being the former and not the latter. So in thinking about digital, we're thinking increasingly, of course, about effectiveness, but also about efficiency, both in our digital spend and how it develops, but also how our digital investment can drive more efficiency in the institution, and that become an increasingly important theme for us. We're also pondering the way in which the digital developments can really contribute to the profile and reputation, and therefore the market position of the institution. And I'll say a few words about that in a moment. Now, again, you'll be familiar with these themes in ways that many of my colleagues perhaps aren't, but we are in, it's an unfortunate metaphor, but it's true, we're in an arms race in terms of facilities, whether it's sport, accommodation, or indeed digital infrastructure within our universities. Students are making very active choices about where they go, and they're reflecting their experience when they're here, in part, due to digital expectations being met. And that's crucial, of course, to the National Student Survey, which is now key to what I think about because of the Teaching Excellence Framework. And therefore, much of our thinking about digital is how will it contribute to student experience, how will it make sure we keep what is a pretty good student experience score currently at Nottingham Trent. And then we're thinking also, how does it affect our students' ability to get jobs? I've said on many occasions to colleagues at university, the metric which matters to me most as a Vice Chancellor is how many of the young people who come here leave and have a graduate level job within 6 months. And in fact, the 16 graduating group, it was approaching 80% had a graduate level job 6 months after leaving us. That's really important to us. But we see how they develop a digital competence while they're here as crucial for employability. And of course, as you will also appreciate, employability is a key metric in the Teaching Excellence Framework. So again, how we use digital to make our students aware of the opportunities around employability support, to have the skills and the way of describing those skills to potential employers is absolutely crucial to them getting the jobs they need and pursuing the careers they came here to enable them to take forward. This is what our Director of Digital Technology wanted me to say about what we do. And he wanted to share some technical information, which I'm not going to gloss, because I'm not sure I fully understand it, but here goes. I think we've had one down in the last 2 years of our network, which is what the 98.99% is about. Okay, so what does it enable us to do? I mean, that's the technical stuff. That's stuff that you understand really well. What does it mean for me as a Vice Chancellor, to my colleagues and to my students? Well, it means we can do these things. Interactions which are novel and creative and create a real sense of innovation around the institution. I'll pick particularly, I think, here the last one, the webcam. About 9 stories above us, at the top of the Newton building, we have 2 peregrine falcons currently sitting on 3 eggs. You can watch them on a live webcam. It gets an enormous number of hits from our students and our staff. It does carry a warning, though, that you may see scenes that may disturb you. Peregrine falcons are very good at taking pigeons and then dismembering them. So we have to warn our students and staff to be conscious of that when they tune in. The other one that I really like is the bees. We have a campus up county at Brackenhurst, near Southwell, if you know this county, which was part of a project for the Milan Expo a couple of years ago, which was the UK pavilion. And what it did was it live streamed the sounds being made by bees in one of the hives, and that controlled the light and the sound that took place in this 18-meter high structure in Milan. Extraordinary piece of network capability. It's now gone to Kew Gardens, where you can now see it, and it's attracted about 40% more visitors than Kew normally gets this calendar year. Unfortunately, the bees are now actually housed in Richmond, not in Southwell. But I thought it was an amazing piece of creativity around art, science, and capability to make this happen. The final thing I'll probably reflect on is the student dashboard. I think if you talk to people in JISC, if you were aware of what we won in the THE Award for a student experience a couple of years ago, We have the best learner analytics of any university in the country. And that's what we've been told. I'm not making that claim idly. And what it does, it records every piece of engagement our students have with the university, in the library, online, in lectures. And we're expanding it to include things they do in the students' union, what they do in sport, and also some personal data that they want to share. The reason that's really important to us is about personalizing our student experience. And crucially, it's about monitoring engagement. Regardless of social background or prior academic achievement, we know that students not engaging with us early in their studies is the largest indicator of students who are likely to leave us prematurely before they graduate. And we can compare every student's engagement with their cohort on their subject group. They can see it, their tutors can see it. And that means we can intervene early and appropriately with those students who we are worried about, who are not engaging in ways that are productive and will mean they're going to stay. Why is that important? Because the third metric in the TEF, of course, is student continuation. We, like most universities, I think have a continuation problem. It is too high. And it is the sorts of network ability that the dashboard gives us which enables to intervene with those students who are most vulnerable. So it's a really practical outcome, both for the university in terms of the TEF, more importantly for the students. Because we know if you go to university and leave, it is more detrimental to your life chances than if you never went to university at all. This is crucial stuff. So I think the network capability we have here, the innovation we're using it for, is really driving our reputation, our profile. I know that's what you're trying to achieve for your institutions. And in fact, I just want to congratulate JISC on being one of those great university collaborations. You're like UCAS, you're like UCEA. You're something that we all do together that we couldn't do apart. And sometimes we underestimate, undervalue JISC, UCEA, UCAS, UUK, because actually we're much stronger doing things together than we ever could be by ourselves. So I hope they're helpful for you introductory remarks. I hope you heard at least 2/3 of them. And have a great 48 hours here in Nottingham. Thank you.
Thank you very much to Professor Peck for an interesting and fascinating introduction. We now know all about the falcons and also the bees. Anyway, I'd like to move on now to the Janet update and introduce you to our two speakers. The first who's now stood up is Roland Trice, and he's going to do the operational talk. So, Roly, over to you.
Thank you, Shirley. Afternoon, everybody. I'm going to take you through the activities of the network's operations group, so the guys that get out there and build things and mend things when they break. So I want to talk about the backbone upgrades we've been working on this year, regional upgrades, some things about DDoS mitigation and attacks, about a new service we're going to pilot with Microsoft Express Route, and then the usual talk about our peerings, our global transit, and a few numbers at the end. So starting in April last year, we started the midterm upgrade of the Janet 6 backbone, and we bought our first Juniper NX 2010 core router, installed that in Equinix Powergate. Somewhere else that you'll see this called Telecity or Telehouse Powergate. The word Equinix is not on the slides where it should be, but never mind. So these boxes, where we only have DC in our POPs, some of the SSE premises only have DC, so these need quite a lot of power. They need 9 power supplies to work, 2 for resilience, so 18 80-amp feeds in there. When we bought these boxes, we could only buy them with AC power supplies, so we need rectifiers as well. So a lot of the equipment in our racks in these POPs are full of electrical kit, as well as the routers, and we're now running off 20-kilowatt systems for the future, for when we get more powerful kit to go in. In July, we got the second MX 2010 installed in Telehouse West. We then waited until after the change freeze across clearing to migrate the services there. We installed 2 more 2010s in Erdington and Loudoun, and then the southern core was upgraded to 400 gigabits. We also started upgrading the access links to some of our regional infrastructure. So the first 100 gigabit connections into regional networks went into the South regional network. So Southampton, Aldershot, and the Inter-Arnet link, and then closely followed in London by 100 gig upgrades into Imperial College and our Stuart House POPs and their Arnet link as well. There's been a lot of work in various regional infrastructures across the country, either as part of the last bits of insourcing and replacing old equipment, or as the result of procurement exercises we've had to do to replace contracts. So there's a lot of work in all of these places. A couple probably need special mention because there's much, much work going on. The first was in the West Midlands, where we had to replace three core routers. We had to do that over a weekend because that's not going to fit into a Tuesday morning maintenance session. So at Wolverhampton, Coventry and Small Heath, which is a suburb of Birmingham, eight regional core circuits had to move across to the new routers and 60 customer connections were moved and migrated. And that was all done and dusted by close of play on the Sunday. Even a bigger piece of work was we got a call a while ago saying that Nottingham Trent University wanted to close their data centre at Clifton and move everything, including our Janet POP, to a new location in Clifton. So this is not a job for the faint-hearted. It involved Janet engineers, teams of people from Nottingham Trent University, Virgin Media and our contractors, and they were all on site from 8 o'clock until midnight to get this done. So 48 fibre connections, both for the East Midlands Man core and connections out to customers. They were cut, spliced onto the new fibres that ran across campus and over to the new POP. And while Virgin Media were doing all that, our guys and the Siena people powered off our racks, pulled all the kit out, stuck it in a van, trailed it across campus, rebuilt it in new racks, connected everything up, powered it up, tested it, and it was all working. Only three customer services were lost during that time, so it does pay to have resilience, not only for the occasional line fault, but for when there's major engineering work coming off as well. And all of the people who did lose service got it back at the time we said it would happen, so this is all good. Connectivity, everything done and dusted by midnight. Our engineers had to clear up a bit, so they finished at 2. So this sort of work requires an awful lot of meticulous planning and execution. And we'd like to thank Tony Hatchie, one of our senior engineers from London, who did a magnificent job on all this, as well as all the other people who were involved, including the guys at NTU, who were very helpful. If you cast your mind back to the end of 2015, you remember the DDoS attacks that occurred on our core infrastructure and to Manchester College. Those attacks to Manchester College carried on into Q1 of 2016. But by this time, we'd arranged with our global transit providers to do some upstream black holing. So the next time we got an attack, rather than having a major incident, it became business as usual. We got on the phone and the attack vectors were blocked by them. We then started a process to block traffic accessing our infrastructure link so that the similar attack to the end of last 2015 couldn't happen again. So between May and June, we phased this in cautiously because back in the distant time when Janet became an IP network, some organizations started using Janet infrastructure addresses as access to some services on their campuses. And it's one of those things that at the time we didn't make a fuss about it because it was a cheap and dirty way of getting stuff done. Of course, now if we start blocking access to these addresses, people are going to lose service. So we had some project managers work with the customers who were in this position and phase them off using our infrastructure addresses so that by the time the Iron Curtain came down, nobody lost any service. In addition, in preparation for installing the DDoS mitigation systems, which I'm sure Steve Kennett will talk about very shortly, we've put provider edge routers at the edge of our network in London and in Manchester to facilitate netflow monitoring of the external peerings. The netflow data is then passed to the DDoS mitigation system and it then uses that to determine if some bad stuff is going on before it wades in and deals with it. We were then set a challenge. Now, I'm told by my boss that we like challenges. It's what makes us get up in the morning. So the challenge in April last year was that the University of Staffordshire would like to use Microsoft Express Route. So this is a service where you put your applications into Microsoft Cloud systems and off you go. So what could possibly go wrong? Well, the university is on the old NetNorthwest network, and we have to deliver a way of getting two diversely routed layer 2 VPNs across that legacy equipment because it's not compatible with the way we do layer 2 VPNs in the Juniper kit on the core. The second challenge was, it's good, but the good news is Microsoft have got a data center in Slough. That's where the service is. Good news, we thought, we have a data center in Slough. What could possibly go wrong? Well, unfortunately, Microsoft are in LD6 and we are in a place called LD5, so it's not the same data center. So we have to provide two diversely routed connections for that. And of course, bearing in mind if this takes off as a service, that's going to be lots of bandwidth, so it's got to be dark fiber. So we need to find two diversely routed dark fiber connections. It's April, and oh, they want this by August. Okay, off we go. So in June, Michael Robson, one of our network engineers in working out of Manchester, very familiar with the NetNorthwest network, he found a way to deliver these diverse VPNs across NetNorthwest. By July, we got two fiber providers. So we got diversely routed fibers to connect to two separate routers in LD6. Both landed in the GIST data center in Slough, which is in itself diversely connected to the Janet backbone, but that's still sort of something hanging off of something else. So eventually, we want to get around and do something else to make sure there's even more resilience in there, but it is a job for later. So by September, testing starts by the University of Staffordshire and their consultants, and by October, we'd gone through a process of being accepted by Microsoft as a premier support partner. Basically, this is all about how we manage incidents, how we hand customers who phone the JSD over to Microsoft, all this sort of thing. Further testing by staffs with support from our engineers, and it was declared ready for service. Again, sterling work done by some of my colleagues, Scott Innes and Robert Stone, out of the NOC. They worked really hard on this, and we thought, yes, this is all good. Just in time for Christmas, we'll sit back and relax now. And then staff started having performance throughput problems. Oh dear. It must be the Janet network, said Microsoft. Now, bear in mind, it's now December. It's the pantomime season. So, as you might imagine, there was a discussion between ourselves and Microsoft. And then we did some very extensive testing over a two-month period, and I'll allude to that later, and proved it really isn't Janet that's the problem. Meanwhile, in early January, five of the East Midlands HGIs had also said they'd like Express Route. The East Midlands network is another one where there's a lot of legacy Cisco equipment. So again, we either had to do a similar thing to get layer 2 VPNs there, or because that network is going to be upgraded anyway shortly, we wanted to replace the routers, we thought we'd just advance that process. So we expedited the purchase of new Juniper routers to put those in at the RNEPs in Nottingham and Leicester. Four new routers were then ordered for other POPs. And as of today, both the RNET routers and the POP at the new NTU Clifton data centre, they've all been upgraded to Junipers. So meanwhile, the testing of the staff links gets serious. We bought from Microsoft some platforms inside their Azure cloud, and we put iPerf up on that and started running a series of tests that started locally and then gradually expanded out over the Janet network in longer and longer loops back into Microsoft. We went into the Network Northwest regional network as well, up to the door of Staffordshire University and back down to Microsoft, and then into staffs through their LAN and their firewalls and out again all the way back down there. And surprise, surprise, we didn't find any problems with the network at all. So the testing was showing that for a 1 gigabit service, transfers, if you're using multiple TCP streams, they work pretty much as you'd expect. You're getting almost line rate, no issues there. The problem is if you're transferring something using a single TCP stream, that underperforms quite a lot. You get low transfer rates and enormous amount of variation of throughput. So you could get low hundreds of megabits in performance, and sometimes that would go down as low as 10 or 12 megabits per second, and then go up again. The initial reaction from Microsoft, well, that's a feature, it's just what it is. It says legacy applications use single stream TCP stacks, so you need to talk to your vendor. So that'd be Microsoft then, won't it? More recently, to be fair, senior developers in Seattle are now involved, and they say that this is wrong. It shouldn't do that. Let's do some more testing. So that's what we're doing. We're doing more testing. But it does show that if you are planning to ship things out into the cloud, you need to understand a bit about how they work and how they will work across longer distances and all of those sorts of things. There's also maybe issues about tuning your end systems. More about that in the second talk and later on this afternoon. So now I'll talk a bit about internet peerings. This is how we connect Janet to the rest of the internet. There are three ways of doing this. So method one is private peerings. So they're direct connections to large service providers who normally they come to us and ask if they want to connect to us. It's usually fibers under the floor at key locations in the UK, and it's mutually beneficial and it saves cost because neither they or us have to send this data via our internet transit and pay for it, and there's quite a lot of it. Secondly, we go via public internet exchanges, so we've connected to the Lynx, the London Internet Mutual Exchange in London, and they've got a presence in Manchester as well now, and we connect to IXI in Leeds. And then finally, we buy internet global transit for the places we can't get to via anywhere else. So we have two suppliers for resilience at multiple connections in London and in Manchester, and each supplier contract is reprocured every 2 years because we keep trying to drive the price down. They have to be tier one transit providers, which means they don't get transit from anybody else, so it's the really big guys, and they must be able to supply connectivity in Manchester and connectivity in London, and they must be completely diverse. We've had offerings in the past where, yes, you can have a connection in Manchester, but then it all goes down to Telehouse in London, and then it goes all the way down to Cornwall and out of the end of the lizard. So now, not only is the Manchester connection, it must not go near London, it cannot leave the UK out of Cornwall, it's got to go somewhere else. This year, the contract that was awarded to Level 3 2 years ago, that was up for grabs. It was won by GTT Communications for roughly half the price of the contract it will replace. And the good news is we signed that contract yesterday, so it is going to come along in August. Those of you who are regular attenders at Networkshop will have seen this slide or something very much like it before. Essentially, it shows that the price for internet transit has gone down and sort of plateaued in the last few years while the usage has gone up. Next year, whoever gives this short, this year a nice drop in the price because half of the global transit will be much cheaper. Again, if you are a regular attender at Networkshop, this is what you'd have seen last year about our external connectivity. We had a terabit of external connectivity. This year, things have moved on. So we've got some new peerings to Amazon, China Unicom, some schools networks from MDNX and Virgin Media, Apple TV, Verizon Edge, UK Cloud, and Apple TV again in Manchester. And then we've upgraded some other peerings, so VM for the London Grid for Learning, Akamai's gone up by 30 gig, Facebook's gone up by 20, and then the big ones, Google's gone to 100 gig. We've moved our Géant peering down to Equinix Powergate and upgraded that to 100 gig. Lynx peering's now gone up to 100 gig, and Akamai's gone up to 40 gig. In Manchester. So we've now got 500 peerings to 300 organisations, and the connectivity's gone up by 400 gig in the last 12 months. So a few numbers. We have 900 organisations connected to Janet and around 1,500 managed circuits. We've got 8,500 kilometres of backbone fibre. We've added 17 kilometres more this year to connect the new northern data centre at Leeds. We've got 200 points of presence, 140 Sienna 6500 optical switches. Some of those have multiple shelves. We've got 212 shelves in total. At Equinix Powergate, we have 8 shelves for one system. And we've got 50 other optical switches, Siennas and Packet Light and various others in some of our regional networks. We have 100 routers in the core of the network. So that's not just the backbone, but we count Docklands as core. The London infrastructure now is pretty much core because of its capacity. 300 routers scattered around our regional delivery areas. 630 end organisation routers managed by our network field engineers in London, the managed router service. And then 150 routers that access provide us out-of-band management access to the IP network, and a further 30 connecting to the optical network. So that's a total of around 1,210 routers, despite Bob Day keep telling us that we're buying too many routers. And finally, a shameless plug for this evening's Birds of a Feather session about incident management. And this is where we'd like some feedback from you guys about how we communicate to you during major incidents and business as usual medium incidents. At the moment, it's normally either a phone call from the Janet service desk or emails sent with trouble tickets in them. Very 20th century. The format of trouble tickets hasn't changed since the 1990s. And of course, it's no good sending you stuff by email if your email has failed or you're not connected to Janet. They're not particularly transparent. For IT professionals like yourselves, yes, you can wade through all this stuff and it means something. If you want to distribute this to your senior management or to your staff or to your students, then you've got to get in and edit it rather than just send it out. During the last major incident simulation we did as a public event with some collaboration from maybe some colleagues in the room, we trialed using text messaging as a way of alerting people that a major incident had happened and that things were going on to check updates for other things. And this proved quite popular with the trial participants. So we're looking to see what media we can use to manage incidents beyond the email and the phone. Of course, the issue for us that trying to manage a database of lots of people's mobile phone numbers is going to be quite difficult. So we want some help with the technology. So we're looking for feedback about this. Do we use the web, SMS, Twitter? We've got a facility now that can send automated phone messages to people about what is going on. And there's a degree of self-management for this, so we can provide you with an account and you can choose who gets told about what and when. So if something has gone really badly wrong, then your vice chancellor or your IT director or whatever can get a phone call or a text message or something else. So if you're interested in this and you want to provide us with some very valuable feedback, then please come along to the BOF session, which is in Theatre 9 at 18:00 this afternoon. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much to Rowley. I won't take any questions yet because you're going to come back after Steve's spoken and we'll take all the questions at the end. So can I introduce Steve Kennett, who's our Director of Security, and he's going to tell you what he's been doing with the security program over the last year.
Just check my microphone. Hey, I've switched it on. We're doing good. Good afternoon. Oh, look, Rowley. I'm Steve Kennett. I'm now the Security Director and Senior Information Risk Owner for JISC. That means I get to put things right, and when it goes wrong, it's all my fault, basically. And my team will agree with that. Up in the top left corner, I can see you guys, no good hiding. So those of you that came to the security conference last year would have been aware that on early November, the National Cybersecurity Strategy was launched, and we had Ian Levy with us on that day telling us wonderful things about flying monkeys and magic amulets. If you've not seen his speech, it's worth going to see that, even though the title is a bit obscure. So really, the cybersecurity strategy helped us in our thinking and the way things are going. And they picked out three key things, really. Defend, deter, and develop. So what's it got to do with us, really? So defend is how we look at protecting JISC and the Janet network, how we become more robust in our defense, and how we look at dealing with incidents and threats. Deter. So this is about when you take action. And I'm going to tell you now that the young gentleman that launched the DDoS attack, which we don't like to mention too often, but in 2015, has been caught. We spent a lot of time working with the relevant authorities, and he is going to court on the 22nd of May for sentencing. That might sound a bit harsh, but actually, you know, we take a strong point of view on this, and we will not tolerate anybody hacking or whatever you want to call it of the Janet network or the JISC services. Develop. This is where we start looking at how we develop our network, our defense, our practices and procedures, and actually making sure that we can respond to incidents and we can protect things rapidly. And also looking at the future, I'll show you our timeline and where we're going with our services later on. And if you really want to find out, there's the link. Have a read if you can't think of anything interesting to do in a bar later on tonight. It's riveting stuff. But it is actually very good, and it gives you a good outline and a good process for starting your security strategy and thinking. GCQ have helped. They've told you what some of the threats are. steal intellectual property, gain unauthorized access, take commercially sensitive data. Most denial of service attacks actually mask some other form of malware being dropped into your system, or thereafter grabbing information stuff. You may have seen recently, yesterday in fact, the England Health said they had 55 ransomware attacks and various other bits and pieces. It's going on all the time. Disrupt government industry service, but the bottom one's more important. Exploit information security weaknesses through targeting partners, subsidiaries, and supply chains. Don't forget your supply chains when you're doing your procurements and stuff. Make sure they have robust processes. So what's a cybersecurity incident? Again, the National Cybersecurity Center, which you heard Ian mention how much he likes JISC up there on the video, they've been very helpful to define this as a security incident. I'm not sure whether we always agree with some of these things, but that's what they say. And when they look at it on a national scale, its impact on the UK's national security economic well-being, or actually the one that worries us more, is the potential to cause major impact to the continued operation of an organization like JISC or your own institutions. Interesting enough, I did a quick analysis with the guys in CSIRT before we came here, and from Networkshop to Networkshop, we saw 15,189 incidents in the last year. That's not a one-off occurrence. An incident for us is when a ticket is raised through all the steps that we take to resolve that incident, whether it's just a little bit of a malware incident or a bit of copyright theft through to a full-on DDoS attack. It just gives you a scale of it. It seems to be holding around about a static number. We don't see it going up and down. We just see a different blend of types of incidents we see. Wouldn't surprise you to find that malware is still top of the list, followed by DDoS. We'll cover more of that later. So who is attacking? Well, it's the usual list. It's the bloke in the hoodie. He must be easy to find by now. You see him the same picture every time. I mean, but you got your hacktivists and your script kiddies, probably more your script kiddies now, where they download a bit of software and run it. They need enough to have the skills to code, and I know we've been talking about machine learning and stuff and just how bad some of the coding is. Insiders. Insider threat is probably one of the top risks now to networks and devices. Whether it's inadvertently an own goal or whether it's disaffected member of staff or employees, this is a big threat. Organized crime. Big money, cybersecurity now. Big money. Interesting enough, we're looking at one of the Russian crime organizations, very enterprising in January. They realized that they have January sales around Europe, and they were actually offering a buy one, get one free sale on the malware they're offering to people to buy. But it's seriously, it's big money. Nation states. You all heard and probably saw the ruckus caused with the recent American elections. Whether or you believe or don't believe that the Russians were manipulating social media streams and causing various fracas with Trump and Clinton, but they're active. The Chinese have a very active cyber warfare division. There's a very interesting guy called GreenSky27. If you want to see him, you can track him now. He was using Twitter feeds and using those to insert malware to take down people that were objecting to the new islands that China had been building around the Sea of Japan. And the latest one that's cropped up now is cyber warfare and cyber terrorism. Daesh, or ISIS, when you look at it, they are starting to have some interesting capability in when it comes to cyber terrorism. And the Syrian Electronic Army are also very active in this front, and obviously it's very topical at the moment. But these are all the threats, and this is always attacking, it's usual stuff. So I'm going to take a little step aside now and show you some of the stuff you can get, and my team are going to cringe now. So you can buy a DDoS attack. You can actually get them for free, but this is a legitimate site, DDoS City. Sorry, Mark. I don't know if you can actually read that, but it tells you they have dedicated servers, untraceable spoof boots, and 24/7 customer care. And if you look at that little red thing on the bottom there, the pointer's not going to work there. They even have a chat online so you can talk to our friendly sales advice people, not mine. There's a tariff look. You can see how much it will cost you. Business lifetime, 90 euros, 1 month basic, 5 euros. And just to prove a point how slick these guys are getting, if it'll come on, they even offer Cloudflare, their own DDoS protection. These guys are sophisticated. This is big money. You know, you can go out and find a network stressor and run it on a network. Sorry, John. John Seymour's now staring at me, giving me evil eyes. You know, it's out there. You need to protect and defend. The guys will tell you more about this in their session later on. But this is what we're up against. Click. So what did we do? We formed, in JISC, the cybersecurity division. We pulled together all aspects that deal with the ST teams that are doing development, the CSET guys doing incident response, guys dealing with what I call critical infrastructure, all the DNS and stuff, and all the services. We pulled them all into one place. It's about people and processes more than technology. You can't get away from the bits of tin. You do need them, but But actually, it's more about having the right people with the right skills and a competent resource. Because you can't use the technology without the appropriately trained engineers. And it's having the processes in place, whether you're looking at 27,000, whether you're looking at CAS-T. So we've actually taken this. We're running on a development ops process. So we take stuff from start to finish, and we're building it through. It's a much more efficient way of working. But we have everything in one place now. We control it. The team see everything that's going on, whether it's incidents, to design, to development. We take our own decisions now on what we do. It's quicker, it's smoother. And I'll come to some bits to prove that later on, hopefully. So what else do? We talk to all these agencies. You can't work in isolation. You know, the NCSC produce a lot of, sounds like I'm doing an advert for Ian now. The NCSC provide a lot of valuable information. You know, they've got CISP. If you can't get into CISP, let us know. We can introduce you to it and get you online. But all these people are actually there to help you, despite being scary. And we work regularly with these. The National Crime Agency we worked with when we were chasing down the young gentleman that caused the inconvenience back in December 2015. The Counterterrorism Internet Referral Unit, we did some work with those last year to take down sites that were producing extremism online, and that ranged everything from the extreme right through to the Islamic threat. There's a whole raft of stuff we do. You cannot work in cybersecurity now and ignore this factor, and we regularly interface with all these people. So, DDoS, you don't really want to listen to me rattle on about cybersecurity. You want to know what we've been doing with DDoS. And there he is. There's Mark again. Sorry, Mark. I promise I wouldn't use this slide, but Mark is one of the analysts, so I put that one on there. Mark is around all day, and Ben should be joining him soon. So we've got two of the analysts on site now to talk to them about the issues. You all know that we had a problem back in December 2015. We know the impacts. I think it was only about 6 hours duration, but it felt like a lifetime, John. Am I right? Yeah. So what have we been doing since we spoke to you last year when we said we were going to do something in DDoS? So this is what we did. So we spent a bit of time, and last year we said we were going through procurement. We've actually got the system now. We switched it on last October. And just as an interesting point of view, it's not actually gone to service yet, but we're watching this. This is what we've seen, some statistics we've seen in the last few months. The largest attack we've seen is 45.9 gigabits. The longest duration was 15 hours. Most attacks in one day, 22. You can read these yourself. But interesting, we start to see the size of potential attack traffic we're seeing, 152 terabytes. That's a lot of traffic. 153 organizations targeted, and the unluckiest organization, 54 attacks. We are looking at this. You can see the graph on the side. No presentation is complete without stats and a graph, but you can see that there. So this is what we've been seeing since we switched it on. Interesting. We've also seen the attacks are getting bigger, typically 5 gigs plus on an average day. If you want to know more about this, come to the BOF tomorrow night. The guys will take you through more great detail. You're starting to see multiple attack vectors coming through now. There are different ways of launching the attacks, and you can start to see the graphs there. You can see the little codes up the top explains what they are. If the pointer would work, that would be more useful, but it doesn't. So, you know, you've got all the different types of attack we're seeing, and we're seeing everything. The beauty of this system is the analysts can now see in more detail what's going on. It gives us a better view. It makes us more responsive. What else? They seem to be more reactive to the countermeasures. Rolly mentioned about MI. We all know that during our incident when we were doing our tweets updates that the little darling was using that against us. You have to be careful what you do. Attacks can happen all hours of the day, 24 by hours, follow the sun, commercial model. You never know when it's going to come, what's going to happen. You can see the different amounts of attacks, UDP floods, TCP-based, the whole lot's going on. And actually, the insider threat is credible. The young gentleman that attacked us was an insider. Let's leave it at that. You've got to be aware of what's going on. We see this all the time. And this doesn't mean we haven't seen this before. Before we got the platform, we were aware of this. It just gives us more visibility, better, quicker, faster. So an example of what we've seen. The bit you need to know about this is if you can see a little bit of green traffic, that's good. Red traffic, that's bad. Not a general rule, but that's a good rule of thumb. So a university was having a few problems, as you can see from the text there. The analyst alerted the university, large DNS reflection attack. They launched mitigation, mitigating 18 gigabits of traffic, CERT liaised with the site, who at that time weren't aware they're under attack. You can see the timescale there. Interestingly enough, some proactive measures were put in, countermeasures in place, just in case they attacked again, and they did. We all know this happens. Again, more DNS and SSDP reflection attacks. You can see the sizes there, and it went on and on and on. This was, I'll stand to be corrected by my team, but this was gamers, and they were attacking other gamers on site in the student accommodation, which doesn't seem so critical, but if they start boring this volume of traffic through the network, one, John gets upset, two, the region gets upset, and it goes on and on and on. Another instance of this, universities, nobody's immune to these attacks. You see the college there had an attack. We notice this, we detect it, we're getting quicker. You can see the volume of attack there, 1.5 gigabits, huge amount of attack from the normal traffic profiles. And previous, same with the previous one, if you look at the college there, you start seeing it's exceeding 20 gigs. If you've got two 10 gig links, that's gonna easily wipe out your capacity to deal with traffic. We launched the mitigation. This is the stuff we're starting to be able to see with our very expensive machine that goes ping. I know John's guys called it Skynet because it's named after the Terminator device, but actually this is what we see. And we'll be doing more about this later, but sorry, John. And its current status. So when I said we switched it on and we're not live yet, we're actually analyzing and doing what, so we can mitigate and scrub attacks. We're developing a DDoS portal. I'm not going to steal any thunder because I think Mark and Henry are going to do that tomorrow and discuss more details on what the portal gives you and the services and what you can see. So I've given away most of it anyway. Sorry, guys. We continue to engage with institutions, what value we can add, how they can see, how we interact. When we mitigate, who do we talk to? We also need to be aware that we are mitigating against true traffic. Just because we see a large spike on the network doesn't necessarily mean that it's attack traffic on the first instance. It could be somebody pushing a large volume of research traffic down the network, so we need to be aware of what we're doing. So we're refining our operational processes, how we interact, what we do. We have created the new cyber division to bring this all into one area. And we are planning yet another two-day conference in the autumn, which I'll give you some more dates and times about that later on. So we're growing the DDoS capability. We're working all the time on this. And I said that if Ben turns up as well, there's two of the guys here. Henry's here. There's quite a few of us from the security division here to come and talk to and find. Rhoda's also mentioned the good work that the guys in the network team do with us in the NOC. But if you want to find out more, come and talk to us. If you want to find more later on, come and arrange a visit, sign an NDA, and we'll tell you more. So what other services? So I mentioned the fact that we pulled everything together. So we've got a whole raft of security services in train at the moment. And what we're doing is growing this and developing more on what we can give out and provide for you guys. So that's the current list of security services we have at the moment. The vulnerability assessment one's in there. You'll see the SMIME extension certificate services on there now. SafeShare is on there. That's now coming out of test and is going live on in May, 24th of May this year. So SafeShare is now available. And we have training. You can't do one without the other. So Shirley's team have put together a training profile, and these are all the training courses that are linked together. Both the links on the bottom are active. If you need some more information, contact us during the day to find out what's there. If there's something that you want that isn't there, talk to us, but I'll get onto how to do that in a minute. So this is the cyber timeline. This is what we've been developing over the last year. So you can see a lot of the stuff. Interestingly, the gap here, we weren't actually not doing anything. This is the bit when we were looking at how to implement and develop the DDoS platform. So there was a huge amount of work going on here. In fact, a massive, massive amount of work. I'm surprised that the guys are still standing, to be fair. Then you can see where we switched it on. So that's the point there. Oh, damn thing. That DDoS phase one was where we actually switched the platform on, as in the previous slides. Moving on, so you can now see SafeShare. Phishing, I'll say more about that in a minute. We've just had sign-off on our business case to do professional services, and one of those key ones in there is Cyber Essentials, which everybody tells us they want to do. So Francis should be around somewhere. If you need to find out more about what we're doing with Cyber Essentials, talk to Francis. And this is feedback we've been getting from you guys, what we want to do. There's a whole raft of other stuff in there. Digital forensics is covered in that piece of paper, as is penetration testing and audit and assessment services. DDoS phase two, that's when we go live. and we're on target for that, and this is when we actually switch it on and start using it in true anger. We're using it now, but this is when it becomes available as a service. And then you can see just security conference, DNS RPZ, and authenticated NTP, all things we're doing. So it doesn't just stop in December at the end of this year. We've got a whole raft of other services we're looking at developing. And you get the chance to tell us what you want. We have an idea of what we need. We're looking at things, what we do with managed services, whether we do managed incident response, whether we provide a managed SOC, whether we do some sort of email filtering. There's a whole raft of services. We have a whole list of stuff we can do. But actually, it's important that you tell us what you need. It's no good me coming out with a service that I think is great, and you tell me, well, Steve, that's lovely, but we don't need that. So this is my top five tips. I was asked to do a blog for Networkshop. So if you're going to do anything to protect your network, these are the five things I suggest you do. And whether we like it or not, in security, we're actually in the business of risk management. What we're doing is looking at the risk and how we manage and mitigate it. You know, it doesn't matter how much you spend. If you don't know what you're trying to protect and what your key information assets are, it's pointless. You need to understand where the risks lie and what you're going to protect. So there's a little point investing in your devices if you don't maintain and enhance their cybersecurity through that period that they're deployed. Don't leave a router switched on for 10 years without patching and updating it. It's make sure you apply the patches. We have the vulnerability service. It pains me to say this next bit, but cybersecurity mitigations aren't infallible. Occasionally, they will get through. So make sure you have some form of incident response on how you're going to deal with this, what you're going to do. If it's a major breach, do you understand what your responsibilities and role is with the ICO and whether you notify them? GDPR, which I mentioned more, is coming in May 18th next year. Everything changes again. And more importantly, it's essential you back it up. Just back up your data. So if anybody does crash your site or lock it out, you can at least restore, and particularly on your critical services. You know, payroll, everybody likes to get paid. Make sure it's protected. So, new service, simulated phishing and associated training. Odd title, it's just phishing service, but actually, it's with Kipu. The guys are out in the foyer, but I suggest you talk to Francis first if you want to find out more about this. They will run phishing simulations, including simulated phishing emails. This is a key thing, and websites. They do training sessions, so we're not just coming to the network or your infrastructure and saying, oh dear, all these people clicked on this email, how sad, you've got a problem. There's actually training that comes with it, like how to increase people's awareness, show them what's happening, understand the risks behind this. You can do branded landing pages for more user awareness. You can have more stats and details, so you can actually look and hopefully show how better people are getting when you run the service. And it should be cost-effective and scalable. So, GDPR, 18th of May next year, whether we like it or not, this comes into force. So, Shirley's team have put together a training package. The first courses are actually being run the 22nd to 26th of May in Manchester this year. You can do the foundational practitioner training course. They can do in-house training if you require it, for minimum number of tens, but there's further dates. But this is brand new service, only came out last week. So if you need more information, contact the training team there. But this is something we can't all ignore next year. It's coming whether we like it or not, and this helps you get ready for it. So, some of you may have seen on Just Mail and the mailing list, we're actually running a cybersecurity posture survey. This is a way that you get to tell us how you think you're doing, what you want, how we can help, what other services we can do. It shouldn't take more than 15 minutes to fill in and complete. There's the link. Please do this. It helps us be informed as to what you want and what to do, and it helps us form our strategy going forward. And it's just useful for us to be able to figure out what to do next, really. So there you go. Just Security Conference. It's going to be in Manchester. We're waiting for the venue to be confirmed. We do know where it is, but we're just going through legal requirements for booking. It's on the 8th and 9th of November. We'll see you there. Use the link at the bottom, justsecurity.ac.uk for events to find out more what's going on. And now I can't stop a shameless plug for what we're doing. We've got a parallel session tomorrow, chaired by Francis, 11:30 to 12:45 in Lecture Theatre 4. And if you want to find out more about the DDoS stuff, we've got a Birds of a Feather session tomorrow night, 16:30 to 17:30 with Henry and Mark on the security analyst. If you want to find out more, go and see what the guys are doing. And at that point, I'm going to shut up.
Thanks very much, Steve. Can we pass over now to Rowley, who's going to do the second part of his talk, and then we'll have questions.
First of all, an apology. Those of you who booked early and looked at the program early will be expecting to see Jeremy Sharp here. Unfortunately, you got the shorter, fatter version of Jeremy today. So I'm going to talk about the work that Jeremy's division, the infrastructure division, is doing, another new division post our reorganization in GIST Technologies. So I'll talk a bit about network infrastructure, about GovRome, about end-to-end performance and the new Liberate service. Because I'm only a representative of the people who do this for a living, there'll be references throughout to the people that you need to talk to if you want to know what's really going on. So starting off with network infrastructure, talk to Neil over there if you want more information. Right, so at the end of my first talk, we had the Janet backbone as it looks today. So 400 gig in the southern part of the core, in the middle we've got 200 gig, and then up to Scotland and off to Bristol we have 100 gig. So in the, over the next 18 months we're planning to upgrade the ARC out to Bristol and the ARC out to Scotland out to 200 gig. I also mentioned that we were upgrading the access lines into our region infrastructures. We're planning to do the northwest, the southwest, and Yorkshire and Humberside, and then we'll look at any of the others that need upgrading and catch them as well. We're going to put a new POP in Slough. Surprise, surprise, we're going to put a POP in LD6, which is where Express Route is. So as I mentioned before, we're currently connected out of our data centre in Slough at 10 gig, and that capacity is going to have to grow. So we're going to upgrade that connectivity initially to 100 gig. We're going to put a big router in at LD6 with 40 ports for customer connections. The LD5 single point of failure issue, we're going to leave that for a bit. Eventually, we'll either put a collector arc in between the two Slough data centres, or we may decide we can go for a second peering to another Microsoft data centre somewhere in Europe, but we don't know. We continue to engage with the research community for people who are doing big research. The headquarters for the square kilometre array, that's going to be at Jodrell Bank, and they're going to need multiple 100 gig connections when they start receiving data from there. So no surprise, we'll connect them directly into the backbone rather than into a regional network. We're also planning to connect Darsbury to the backbone because they need multiple 10 gig connections for a number of services they're running, both IP and for light paths. And we regularly engage with similar sorts of organisations as well, EBI and the Met Office and the usual suspects. We're beginning to have discussions with Siena about moving to 400 gigabit technology. I was told originally we might be the first people in Europe to do this. There was some growling from one of my colleagues in London yesterday that says that might not be true. But anyway, if we do this, it'll be a fairly major piece of work that will need new hardware and new software across the deployed infrastructure. So that's quite a lot of work if we decide to go down that route. We're starting a program of consultation about the future architecture of the network. It's one of the things we do on a regular basis. The last time we came out and pestered you all was leading up to the Janet 6 program, so it's about time we started to do this again. We need to be sure that what the network we provide continues to provide you with the services you need, both in terms of capacity, in its flexibility and its agility. It still needs to be highly reliable and highly available, as we've seen today. At the same time, as was mentioned in the first lecture today, money is becoming tighter across the board, so you are requiring to see costs go down, and so are we. So we're looking to make savings on the way we buy infrastructure. The first discussions we had with this were with the East Midlands IT Directors Group, and further consultations are planned. We need to look at new procurement vehicles. One of the things that costs us an awful lot of time and money and effort is these five-yearly forklift upgrades to our infrastructure, essentially because procurement regulations say that after so many years you've got to re-procure. So what we want to do is have longer contracts for access circuits in particular to allow for some growth, but over the 5 years we tend to find we end up replacing a lot of circuits with similar circuits. So if we don't have to do this, it will be good, but we also need to allow for some change, for some consolidation, for people moving connections around without getting big penalties later on in the contract. There's no good getting a cheap deal only to get screwed later on. So we want to avoid replacing tail circuits because of regulations. What tends to happen in these big procurements is we do a big procurement and then either the telco is late, so we end up having to pay for the old network, And if that's with a contractor who didn't win the next procurement, then they tend to try and take a lot of money off us for short-term extensions. And the second one is customer inertia. Now, this is a natural thing. If we come along to a customer and we say, well, we're going to take this 1 gigabit circuit away, we're going to put an identical one in, but of course, this is disruptive. It needs work. You don't want to do it in term time. You don't want to do it at a reasonable time of the day. And all of the very valid reasons that a customer will have for not doing it today because they've got other things to do means that we end up paying for the old circuit and the new circuit in parallel, sometimes for weeks or months, and that can add up to hundreds of thousands of pounds a year that we, to be blunt, don't have anymore. Brexit, it says, unlikely to come to our rescue. I don't see anybody in Parliament rushing to get around the current public procurement regulations. That's going to be so low on people's agenda, it'll be buried by the Thames flood barrier not being fit for purpose anymore by the time they get around to fixing that. However, there is some good news. You may have heard BT Openreach have been told they need to start selling fibre to people. They've not done so for many years, and they've now been told they have to do this. There's still some wiggling, I think. They're appealing a bit, but the chances are that come the end of the year, they're going to have to start providing dark fibre to people. And essentially, this is access circuits. So what they will be doing is taking the NTEs off their bit of glass that they provided you with, sticking about 10-15% on the bill, and off you go. You've got dark fibre access circuits. There are going to be some distance limitations on this, probably around 40-45 kilometres. So it's unlikely we could build big regional networks using this technology, but access circuit costs can come down, and if we can get hold of dark fibre for long leases, then we've future-proofed the requirements of our customers, so this should be good. We're going to start looking at lower cost optical solutions so we can either for regions or for access links so we're not having to put enormous amounts of money into DWDM solutions. Other telcos are not going to sell the dark fiber, mainly because they don't have as much as BT do. However, they are using a different delivery technique. It used to be that in order to allegedly cut cost, you could buy an access circuit from someone like Virgin Media, other suppliers are available, short tail circuit into their network, and then they plug this circuit into some sort of managed MPLS cloud, ping it across the country, it can pop up in a region or it can be diverted down to London or anywhere you like, and it comes out on another short piece of glass. And this was touted at the time as a good way to provide low cost access circuits in a regional network. What we discovered is it didn't do this, mainly because it cost quite a lot of money for people in our community, lots of 1 gig connections going over these managed MPLS cloud. The companies would rather sell that in penny packets to other people and make more money. The other problem we found is they weren't particularly transparent, so this was tended not to be very good. So the solutions they're now offering is using low-cost optical equipment to connect in access circuits and provide access circuits using an optical system. It's much simpler to upgrade and we can get it at a predictable cost. So we've got a potential here to aggregate regionally. So if we're having access circuits delivered over an optical network, we could deliver these straight into a regional network entry point or maybe straight into the Janet 6 backbone. So potentially we've got no regional backbones at all, because all of our connectivity demands can be met by dark fibre into the core network. Get rid of a lot of routers, get a lot of expense. So this potentially could be very good. However, the proof of the pudding will be in the eating. The proof will be getting sensible and sensibly priced and sensible technical solutions to when we start in putting out tenders. So hopefully Neil or Jeremy will be able to tell you more about this in a year or two's time, but at the moment it's just jam tomorrow. I want to talk a bit about GovRoam. Mark O'Leary is the GovRoam expert if you need to talk to him later. So what is GovRoam? The project is to deliver a roaming Wi-Fi service to the public sector. It uses their existing infrastructure. It's got a national scope. It suits their basic needs for the public sector organisations, and it's a first step is a service delivery platform. So the idea in the first phase of this is to get the connectivity out there, and if somebody wants to put in more layers of security or serviceability or applications or whatever, that comes later. So it's definitely a walk before you can run the service. And it needs to be at an appropriate security level. If you look back over the history of public service networks, when they first started to come into vogue, there was a lot of push about security and putting lots of security into the network and then pricing it out of the reach of the public sector. So at this stage, we're doing as little as we can get away with, and if you want to put some more security on there, then get some secure VPN technology and provide that to your users. Where are the business drivers for this? Well, if you listen to the news, you listen a lot now about the integration of health and social care. So social workers and healthcare professionals are having to work in a multiplicity of institutions. You get multiple occupancy of buildings. Mark was telling me a story about a local authority that had it rented a new office block, 7 different departments, 1 on each floor. And if they wanted to meet, to have meetings and talk about collaboration, it was easier if they needed the network to go down to the coffee shop in the basement and use their free Wi-Fi than it was to get the guest access at any of the networks in any of these 7 rooms. So that's where they are now, and running something like GovRoam would be really good for them. They also have, you know, peripatetic workers. People who work at multiple sites are all going to benefit from such a service. And of course, there's savings to be made because you don't have to reinvent the wheel for every local authority. So what we're doing is we're helping to establish policy. So this is about trust. It's nothing about the technology itself. It's a cooperation agreement. It's based on the fundamental principles of everybody gets access to a common standard. There's collaboration across all the people taking part in the project to resolve their issues. And most importantly, it's settlement free. So nobody is charging anybody else for the using of their facilities. Now, in our community, this is bread and butter. We've been doing this for years. In local authority, in the public sector, this is less so. Local authorities in particular have been sort of standalone fiefdoms for a very long time, and whilst there have been efforts to encourage collaboration, they're nowhere near down the road as we are. So this is all something that we're pushing gently in this, and in some places it's getting more like EduRome. But as I say, if you think this is like EduRome, you'd be right, well spotted. So what are we doing? We are a neutral operator, so basically we're running the service. We help bring new customers on board. We do the monitoring and reporting. We do the troubleshooting. We facilitate advice about the governance. And we are an interface to any emerging public sector roaming initiatives in other countries when they emerge. Why is it separate from EduRome? Well, it needs different governance, and not all the participants can or want to integrate with our network. However, it is very easy to offer both, and if you're able to do this, we strongly advise that you do so. Technically, they're compatible, so if you've got a venue where communities mix and where there's some local agreement, then go for it. The pilot phase has started. We've got a collaboration from a number of organisations, and it's a mixed bunch, a lot of health trusts, and then some of the public sector networks, so Yorkshire and Humber and London, and Kent PSN, a guy who's retired very recently called Jeff Walbank, has been a major guy pushing this through at all levels. He's backed us up, talking to the Cabinet Office, to the government, to anybody who would listen, and he's been very much responsible for bringing this on. Certainly within Kent, and the sort of organisations and the sites they're taking, anything you can think in the public sector, from museums, leisure centres, fire stations, etc., they can all have been running this. The list of future participants as well, so some bigger organisations, so NHS Digital, the public service networks in Wales and in Scotland, we're talking to the Cabinet Office, multiple county councils, blue light services, etc. And there's a production service that's going to come in to launch in the summer. If you want further information, David Hayling from the University of Kent is going to talk about how he's put GovRoam up
alongside his initial existing Edge Your Own deployment. So that's Lecture Theatre 7 at 4:15 this afternoon. End-to-end performance, again, any further details, see Tim Chown. So the background to this, we are supporting the growth in data-intensive research applications being across Janet and running internationally. An example of this is the community that do cryo-electron microscopy. I had to look it up as well, I don't really know. However, the issue they have is they may have a lot of scientific equipment located on their community, and that collects results, and then they have to ping that away to a friendly high-performance computer center to get it processed, and they need a 10 gigabit circuit to get their results back within a reasonable time. So they bang all that off, get it computed, and back in 30 seconds. That's quite a lot of bandwidth. Our mission is to help sites make optimal use of their Janet connectivity, so apply controls and performance methods to their local campus network engineering to tune the equipment on their campus, to run a network of performance measurement tools so they can see how performance is across their network, across our network, to other sites, and then to help them configure and tune the data transfer nodes and tools that they have. Based on visits we've done in the community, there are already some good examples of this. Again, if you have been a regular attender at Networkshop over the years, you'll know that the particle physics community has always been at the forefront of pushing the bounds of the Janet network, all the way back to the time when our connectivity to the US were, we provided our own, so we had a 34 megabit circuit and six T1 1.5 megabit circuits, and the physics community were adamant that their traffic should only go over the 34 megabit circuit because they didn't want it salami sliced over the low bandwidth stuff. So they've always been very keen in getting the most out of the network that they can, and they now have a grid of perf sonar measurement systems, which they use between grid PPP sites to keep an eye on what's going on. We're also starting to see now, as I've mentioned already, requests for people having 100 gig research connectivity to Janet. Raw bandwidth will get you so far, but unless your end systems are tuned to make the best advantage of it, as we saw earlier with the talk about Express Route, then you may not be able to get as much throughput as you want. So we've got a wee diagram here. If you run, this is the grid PP's perf sonar mesh. So you can see that they have a bunch of machines making connections to other bunches of machines and looking at the throughput they get over the network. So if it's green, it's running in excess of 900 meg. If it's yellow, it's below 900, but more than 500. And the orange there is if they can't find the perf sonar machine. If you get this grid, this is all available on the web, and you hover over the hover your mouse over one of those squares, you then get this information in the grey box about the throughput in both directions. If you click on that square, you then get a graph giving more details of the connection there measured over quite a reasonable period of time. So that's happening now. So we're visiting sites, we're documenting, we're sharing best practice. We're encouraging the deployment of network measurement tools. We've got 10 gigabit perf sonar test node up and running in London, and we are planning for another one at the Slough data center. And I am told that you can get a machine to run a gigabit perf sonar testing system for less than 250 quid. So it's not something, if you want to set this up, that's going to break the bank. So we're going to operate perf sonar measurement meshes. For the Janet communities. If you want more information about this, Tim Chown's talking today at 4:15 in Lecture Theatre 4. And finally, Josh apparently isn't here today. We think he's going to be here tomorrow. So Liberate. Currently, we offer three different access management solutions on Janet. One is the UK Access Management Federation, which is web-based content and services. We run Edge Your Own for sharing Wi-Fi networks, and we run Ascent, which is for non-web-based e-infrastructure services.
Liberate is a service that will reduce the cost and complexity of adopting and using these three services on your campus. So it's a cloud-based platform managed by us, and it will help you integrate these three services with your existing identity management systems. It will help you configure and manage the use of these services, and it will monitor and report on the use of those services. It will also allow you to simply integrate with your institution's active or LDAP directories. Currently, we're in pilot. We're talking to several public libraries and a number of organisations within our community. In July, we will have a beta service available at no cost, and the production service is scheduled to start in September, at which point a tariff will apply. So you can get more details from Josh or Simon Cooper, who is here, because I've seen him. Josh's Liberate BOF tomorrow is at 4:30 in Lecture Theatre 9. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Rowley and Steve. Has anyone got any questions for either Rowley or Steve, or do you want to catch them privately later on? Okay, Ian. Wait.
If anybody was interested in further information on Express Route, would there happen to be another session, say, tomorrow morning at 9:15 in Lecture
this is
Theatre
Ian
4,
doing a plug for
where
this.
We'll be talking more about that?
Do you know, Ian, I think there is.
Splendid. In that case, it's all aboard the Cloud Express.
Okay, well, any questions there? So if anyone wants to catch Steve and Rowley, they will be here for that until the end of the conference, so please choose your moment. Anyway, can I introduce our next speaker, who's Miranda Mowbray, who's got over 25 years' experience in industrial IT research. Her recent research interests include machine learning for cybersecurity, big data ethics, and security for the Internet of Things. And Miranda is going to talk about machine learning for network security. That seems very appropriate. Miranda.
Thank you. Oh, good, it's working. Before we start, I would like to do a stretch. I don't know if it's the same for you, but if I sit in one place for more than an hour and don't move, my brain seizes up. So anyone who wants to join me, stand up, do a quick stretch, smile at your neighbour and sit down again. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3, stand up, stretch. Stretch, smile at your neighbour, and sit down. Okay, great. How do I move it on? No. Okay, I'm Miranda Mowbray. Until very recently, I was employed by Hewlett-Packard. They closed down their European research labs, and so I'm no longer employed by Hewlett-Packard. It's important that you know that everything I say is my opinion and nothing to do with Hewlett-Packard, okay? I'm looking for a job, so if you'd like to hire me as a speaker or something longer term, then you will see my email address in the conference details. And I have lots of people to thank. Most of the people on that slide are my ex-colleagues who worked on me with the things I'm talking about. I also would like to thank Networkshop for inviting me. And also people who kept Janet running when I profited from it as a student and researcher. Okay, I'm going to start with very gently with telling you what machine learning is. You probably all know. You can see it's quite trendy. Interestingly, if you're interested about those troughs, those are the Christmas holidays. People are not interested in machine learning during the Christmas holidays. I don't know why. The difference between machine learning and traditional computing is instead of having fixed software that transforms your input into the output, the software itself is transformed as it goes along, either with training data or it adapts to all the inputs that it gets all the time. That sounds really cool and maybe magical, but no, not really. An example of the equivalent of machine learning is salt to taste. If you've ever done a recipe that says salt to taste, what it means is try this out, and the recipe itself is adapted over time depending on what happens with the input and the output. It's machine learning, except a computer does it rather than the cook, the chef. Okay, two different kinds of machine learning algorithms. One is supervised and one is unsupervised. Supervised machine learning, what you're given is you're given some examples of what it ought to look like. So training data, for example, you might get, if it's a clustering problem, you'll be given examples of items within each of the clusters that you're supposed to identify. And linear regression, fit the data into a straight line and then use that straight line as your model. Logistic regression, similar, Hilliard Markov model, similar, decision trees for a classification problem. You see how to build something that will produce the classification that you're told is the right one. With unsupervised learning, instead, you're just given a large amount of data and say, tell me something about this data set. So clustering, tell me groups of points in this data set that are similar to each other. Principal component analysis, tell me the combination of measures that will give me most information about different points in this data set. And anomaly detection, which is the one that's usually used for security, is tell me things that look weird. Tell me points in this data set that just look a long way from everything else. Okay, that's machine learning. How is it used in network security? Well, the question that you answer in network security is you have a lot of things, which one of them is bad? So you have a lot of spam, a lot of emails being sent to people in your network, which ones of them are spam? They're visiting lots of websites, which of them are phishing websites? They're downloading lots of PDFs, which one of them have malware, same with executables. There's loads of communication happening in your network. Which of those communications are consistent with the propagation of a worm from one machine in your network to another? And one I will talk more about is which communications do you see, which attempts to communicate with external domains are consistent with an infected machine contacting its malware controller outside the network. And sometimes you want to say what kind of bad as well. So when you know that something's bad, it's useful to know what kind of family of malware it is, what type of malware, if it's malware, because that helps you decide what should be done about it. Machine learning is used for that too. Okay, some issues with using machine learning for network security as opposed to other applications. Okay, so here are some things about network security. Firstly, we have an adversary. You're not just trying to find things about fixed laws of the world. You actually have somebody who is trying to fool you actively. This is what makes it fun. What we're looking for is rare, we hope. So instead of finding general patterns that are true for most things, we're trying to identify things that are really different from what's usually the case. Our data can be quite big, as I'm sure you know better than me. In the environment where I did this, the network data was really very diverse. Loads of different applications, loads of different operating systems, loads of different countries. And I think in university networks, it tends to be more diverse than, say, a factory automation network. So you'll have that problem too, or that opportunity. And finally, some of the data that we look at is personal and confidential or even sensitive. That's important to take into account. Okay, so firstly, there's an adversary. Right, Symantec's Internet Security Report in 2016 said there was over 1 million a day new pieces of malware in 2015. And that hasn't gone down, I believe. If you think about that, that can't be just individually handcrafted. There aren't all that many bad people in the world. And this means that the previous way of detecting malware, which was to have a signature, which is just a string that you could identify in a file, doesn't work because there's polymorphic malware which is changing the file each time. It's generating new malware each time. This led to a wonderful quote, which was head of antivirus firm says antivirus doesn't work anymore. All the main security firms are now going from looking for specific signatures to looking for patterns, more general patterns. Because of this, the adversary is changing their malware each time it's communicated. Oops. Okay, rare events. I'm going to show you the issue with rare events with an analogy from airport security. This is Denver airport security, where I lost my bag. I did get it back. So imagine you have something in a you have a face recognition system in airport security with a false alarm rate of 0.1%. So one time in 1,000, it will look at somebody who's not a terrorist and say, "Ooh, I recognize that person. It's a terrorist in my terrorist database." Okay, if you do that, and less than one person in a million is a terrorist, this means that you get nearly 1,000 false alarms per true alarm. So if you hear the alarm, what should you do? Ignore it, I think. If you do this in Heathrow, you get a false alarm every 16 minutes, and everybody says, "Turn that thing off!" This is not a theoretical problem. This actually happened in Heathrow. Shortly after 9/11, they trialed a face recognition system. I don't know what their false alarm rate was, but it was large enough to produce so many false alarms that it didn't last very long. And this is also a problem for network security. Even if you have a really small false alarm probability, because the, you're looking for rare events in a large amount of data, you can end up with an awful lot of false alarms. So what can you do? Well, either you can reduce the sensitivity, so you missed a lot of bad things that are going on, and you you hope you only spot the ones that you miss are the less important ones, or you can take actions which are not as disruptive as setting off an alarm bell or going ping, as you said, each time. You can, for example, automatically block certain traffic from sensitive parts of your network. You can delay it, that sort of thing. But it is a problem. And I do know of people, of companies that bought very expensive security software and then switched it off, which really doesn't help. Big data. Okay, this photo is me and one of my colleagues holding a printout in 6-point font of what we store as a result of one DNS lookup. So this is, for those of you who don't know about DNS lookups, this is if you a machine in your network uses your DNS resolver server to try and visit an external website. So this gives you an idea of the amount of data that we store for one of those. And we were getting 16 billion of these a day from the networks that we were. So it's a lot of data. Supposing one in a million of those lookups are actually caused by malware. If you rang an alarm each time, you get 12.5 true alarms per minute to the security operations center, and they would turn it off, right? So this is a problem as well. What do we do? Well, it's important to cluster together all the events that are caused by the same underlying cause, if you can do that. It's also very important, if you can do it, to prioritize what's something that's really threatening your network now and something that you can work on less immediately. Sometimes you can take automated response. So if you're pretty sure of what's going on, you can send an automated message to the employee concerned saying, "This is wrong with your computer, this is what you should do to fix it." But it's a problem. Oh, and another thing you can do is we worked on visualization of a very large number of alarms so that instead of having just an alarm bell going off every few seconds, you have dots on a picture where the dots on the screen give you an overview of the general picture of the health of your network. One thing that you get with diverse data, and especially with large diverse data, is ugly ducklings. These are things that are rare and a bit weird, but they're good. So the ugly duckling is actually a swan, which is good. This is a coot. Isn't it beautiful? And an example of an ugly duckling comes from spam. This is a Korean spam gift set. They give each other... Yes, okay. Not that kind of spam, the bad kind of spam. As you probably know, pretty much all spam filters use machine learning. They use Bayesian machine learning. And what they do is they say, given what I've seen, given what I know about this message, is it more likely to be bad or good? And one academic some time ago looked at the main English language Bayesian spam filters and found that they were blocking all emails from South Korea. because at the time there were a few spam companies who were sending their spam through South Korean servers. And if you're English speaking and you receive an email from South Korea, it was more likely at that time to be spam than not spam. Well, this is terrific, unless you have friends and family and business colleagues in South Korea. So that's an example of an ugly duckling. Obviously, Koreans are good. The cure for that one was a more targeted training. So you train on what was spam to you in the past. And if in the past you had emails from Korea that were good, then it won't identify it as spam. And, I mentioned person confidential data. This is something that I care about personally. I looked at the data that I was allowed to access as a security researcher, and it really spooked me. And I helped develop a code of practice for making sure that we were looking after the data respectfully and keeping it securely. What I did, actually, I got a colleague to pseudonymize some data, and then from that, I tried to deduce things about the pseudonymized data, and my goodness, I'm really glad it was pseudonymized. Okay, so now I've been talking in general. Now I'm going to talk about a particular example of using machine learning for network security, which is detecting domain generation algorithms. I'll tell you what they are. This is just a metaphor, no actual UFOs involved, okay. In the past, right, let me start again. If I infect your computer, generally I will want some way to communicate with you, to tell you what to do. So I might say, host this spam website, or get together with all this group who I've infected and attack that person with a DOS attack, or you get the idea. And so traditionally, I would put something in my malware that would say, as part of the instructions, phone home to Miranda's evil domain, where you'll have a message waiting for you. But if you are a white hat researcher and you discover that Miranda's evil domain is bad, then you can put it on a blacklist and share it with all the other network admins. And now I can't talk to you because all my traffic is blocked. And so malware authors came up with a really ingenious way of making sure that they could evade blacklisting. So instead of having a fixed domain in the code contains a little algorithm which every day generates a batch of domains, a whole lot of domains. I have a copy of the code too. And so every day I move my flying saucer over one of the domains there. I register it, for example, and use that. You try to communicate to all the domains in the batch. Those communications, all but one of them will fail, but one of them will get through to me, and that's the domain that I'm using today. And if, I can't remember who it was, you, that's right. If you discover the domain I'm using today, well, I can move to another one in the batch, but in any case, it'll be a different one tomorrow. Cool. And this is an example of it actually happening in a real network. I should explain each dot is either a machine in the network or a domain that we think is dodgy, an internet domain. The colors and placement of the dots is just to help you see patterns. And there's a connection if a machine in the network is trying to make a connection to a bad domain. And you can see it normally looks like that, but sometimes it looks like that. And in the center of the yellow rows there, there is one infected machine which is infected with ransomware, and it's trying to connect to a huge number of different domains. The great thing about this is if you can spot it, it's possible the connection happens before the ransomware encrypts all your files and asks for money. So if you can spot it, then you can get the machine disinfected before anything bad happens. But actually, the best way to deal with ransomware is back up your data. If you back up your data, you won't have a problem. This chap said back up your data too. Good advice. Okay, so I said that those domains were dodgy. If they use a different domain each time, how do we know they're dodgy, right? Never seen them before. Well, here is a list of some of the domains used by that family of malware. And if you look at them, you can see that they're not really like gist.uk. They're not really like hp.com. They look a bit different. And there's a kind of family resemblance, right? they look like they belong together in some way. So it's plausible that you might be able to train a machine to recognize that family. You give it lots of examples of it, and you get lots of examples of domains that were perfectly okay. And it would learn to distinguish between the two. And that's exactly what we did. We used logistic regression with L2 regularization, for those of you who want the technical details. We trained it on a set of normal domains and samples from known families of domain generation algorithms. And we used all sorts of features of the domain name. I've just listed a few. There's a lot more. And it's okay. It actually works. It doesn't have to be enormously accurate in order to work well, because what we do is we only say that something is fishy if it's trying to connect to a large number of domains in a particular family that we think are fishy, right? So if we miss a few, that's all right, because it's going to connect to everything in the batch. If we miss a few in the batch, it'll still trigger an alarm. And if we falsely identify a perfectly ordinary domain as a bad one, that's okay, because it's unlikely to have the same machine in our network connecting to a lot of these, right? So it works, it's nice. But it only works if we have a sample of domains generated by that algorithm, right? What if some malware, new malware comes up that uses a completely different algorithm? There are some malware families that share the same algorithm. But if somebody, some malware author uses a completely new algorithm, what do? We have no samples from it. Okay, so before I give an answer to that, I have a quiz. So I have four domains there. I'd like, if any of you can tell me which one of those you think was randomly generated using software, which ones of them were randomly generated, or which ones of them were directly invented by a human being? Anybody got an idea? Put your hand up. Or if you've got an idea about one of them. Can't see any hands. Yes. The second one's real. Why? Yes, it's Polish. Absolutely. You're right. It's real. It's Polish. And it means ways to save money. And I think Polish is a beautiful language. And I got really annoyed when my first attempt to identify bad domains identified all Polish domains as bad. Anybody else? Yes! So this gentleman speaks LeetSpeak. The third one, for those of you who haven't already seen it, is pizzadelivery.com. Any more? The first one. So you think it's good or bad? You think it's good? It's actually bad. So, but I would have thought it was good as well. If you look, it says, "Do you understand me?" So the examples that I showed you, the letters were chosen at random, but there's also malware that takes words and phrases in this case and mashes them up together to produce domains randomly, and this actually came from malware. And the last one, I'll tell you, it's Chinese. It's a Chinese acronym, the normal way of changing Chinese internet domain names into the English language is you take the English transcription of the Chinese words and then you take the first letter of each word, or syllable, I think. And this is something in Hainan province, which is why it starts HN. And because of that, the average length of Chinese domain names is shorter than English domain names, and I'll come to that point later. Okay, so before we started working on this, there are two basic ways in which they tried to find new domain generation algorithms. One was to say that domain names that are generated by human beings tend to be readable and pronounceable by human beings, and they have various linguistic features. I've just shown you some problems with that. The second one, which works really well, is to look for clusters. Remember, machine learning, clustering algorithms is one type of machine learning. Clusters of similar domains. So you look for domains that are similar and that are connected to within the same, about the same time by multiple computers in your network. And the idea is if multiple computers in your network are infected with the same set of malware using the same domain generation algorithm, they'll all connect to the same group. And they'll be similar because they use the same domain, the same algorithm. And this was used by Anton Akakis and others on 18 months worth of data from a large ISP network to discover 12 families of domain generation algorithms, six of which were previously unknown. But there's a problem with this, which is, or a weakness with this, which is you can only discover an attack when it's already affected several of machines in your network, right? It would be nice to discover it when it's affected the very first machine before it starts propagating. And we look for a way to do that. Okay, so this uses something called the two-length. This is just technical. The two-length is the length of the string between the last two dots before the public suffix. The public suffix is something like .com, .ac, .uk. And typically the way that domain generation algorithms, which basically the code is copied from malware to malware, they pick a two-length. They then pick a random string with that length, then they add a suffix, and sometimes they add a prefix. And therefore, you would the very first thing that they do is they start with a distribution of two lengths. So we thought we'd look at whether the distribution of two lengths of rare domains that a computer tries to connect to is unusual. Okay, so we're only looking at rare domains, because if you're connecting to bad domains, those bad domains will not be connected to by everybody every day. They're recycled deliberately. We're looking at the distribution of the two lengths of those domains that they're connecting to, and we're looking to see whether a computer has an unusual form of this distribution, because we think it might be different from the usual distribution of two lengths for our network. The picture is of an unusual distribution of pizza lengths. Okay, we use the standard statistical difference between distributions. We look at the overall distribution for Chinese-speaking employees and the overall distribution for non-Chinese-speaking employees, and we compare what's happening with your machine to the average for your group. And if it's sufficiently far out, then at that point, I look at to see whether you're connecting to a lot of domains that don't resolve, because you're going to be connecting to all the domains in the batch and only one of them will resolve. And if so, then I think maybe you're infected by a domain generation algorithm. This is a way of discovering domain generation algorithms that we didn't know anything about before. Okay, why only two lengths? Why pick that measure rather than any other measure? There are loads and loads of measures that you could have. Well, I originally designed this to work with data that had, for privacy reasons, pretty much the only things I knew about it was whether the domain resolved, what its two length was, and what its public suffix was. So I could have used its public suffix and its two length. But when I did that, I got ugly ducklings. I found computers in our network that had a really, really unusual domain suffix distribution, because they were connecting to huge numbers of domain, a huge proportion of the domains they connected to ended .ee. .ee is not electrical engineering, it's Estonia. This wonderful thing is from Estonia, it's in Tallinn Town Hall. And these machines were not infected, it was just Estonian employees. And I had the same thing for other small countries. But when I looked at two lengths, I didn't find the same problem. There wasn't the same concentration of unusual behavior in single people. The question you always have to answer if you're ever using any security detection method is, what will the bad guys do in response? Okay, we're playing a game of chess here. So supposing you're a malware author and you want to get around this system, you want to design an algorithm that won't be detected. What do you do? Well, you do it with a distribution of two lengths that is the same as the one in our network. Yeah, how do you know what that is? I've done this in several networks, in three large networks, and the distribution is significantly different in the three. And I suspect it might change over time as well. In order to know what the distribution of rare domains is in our network, you would have to collect an awful lot of our network traffic, and we would probably have other problems as well, rather than just the initial attack problem. And you would have to get a distribution that was sufficiently close both to the Chinese distribution and the non-Chinese distribution, because otherwise, as soon as your malware affects a Chinese-speaking employee, we'll detect you. So I think we're probably safe, and that's why I feel okay talking about this. Okay, the result was we looked at 5 days' data, one day from each of 5 months, so it's kind of 5 months' data, but only 1 day from each month, as opposed to 18 months of data, and we found 19 domain generation algorithms, 9 of which were previously unknown to us. Some of them, it turned out one had been discovered before, and a few were discovered later. But so that's the result. Here are some examples of ones that we found. I should say we didn't use these directly to detect infected machines. What we did was we used it to collect examples of domains from this new algorithm, and then we used that to train a detector for future domains from this algorithm. And I think the first two, you can see that they look a bit weird. But the third one, when I saw appointment solve, I said, nah, that's not randomly generated. It is, it's randomly generated. And it's not obvious that you could detect it, but you can. Okay, so that's the past. The present and future, I think the big problem for security is going to be the Internet of Things, or the Internet of Toasters. The phrase the Internet of Toasters comes from the Twitter profile of a toaster that tweets. I was talking to some of the people from Warwick University, and they're saying they're already having problems about internet-connected washing machines on their network. I saw some... I was unable to confirm it, but I saw what looked like some very interesting, possibly malicious behavior from forklift trucks. And, you know, you need to be careful with forklift trucks because those can kill you, right? So that's what I think is the problem for the future. And now I'm ready for questions.
Thanks so much, Miranda. Have you got any questions? Coming back up with a microphone.
Hi, so that was really interesting, thank you. In terms of the domain problem, do the registrars do anything, or are they compelled in any way to try and detect the registrations of these domains?
Yeah.
Or do they just want the money and happily register anything?
It depends on the registrar, but the large registrars do cooperate absolutely with blackholing bad domains. But there are some registrars where their business model is just anyone can register. There has been some pressure being put on registrars who aren't cooperating by governments and government organisations, and that has made things a bit better. But, you know, it's hard for them to know. I mean, how do they know that these domains are being used for bad purposes until somebody reports them? And then, yeah.